This is Let's Talk Real Estate with Corina Cisneros on 101.5 WEEI Sports Radio Lakes Region. Once again, here's Corina.
And we are back. This is Corina Cisneros with Let's Talk Real Estate, and we are reminiscing on the best of the best that we had in 2019. I remember Leslie Bryant from Bryant Paving. She gave us some great information about paving driveways. Let's listen in. What has changed in paving from 11 years ago to today? Is the technology still the same?
The technology is similar. There is much more automation in the industry now than there was. There was the automation in the industry, but it was mostly scaled to the larger jobs, highway work, road construction work, airports, things like that. Currently, they're bringing more automation into more engineered parking lots and things. So the automation or the technology hasn't necessarily changed. It's just expanding into more areas.
Okay. So I'm a homeowner. Many people listening are homeowners. Some of us don't have a paved driveway. I have a partial paved driveway in my house. Why would somebody want to pave their driveway?
Sure. I guess there depends on what your priorities are, right? So if your priorities are having a safe place to travel, getting in and out of your driveway, if you've got the typical New Hampshire driveway that's full of potholes and heaves and what have you, and you're tired of navigating that, that's a good reason to get your driveway paved. If you're tired of cleaning the sand off your floors from all the wear and tear that comes in the house from the driveway, that's a good reason to get your driveway paved. One of the best reasons is because it looks good from the street. Once you pave it, kind of makes that landscape pop right out. So lots of good reasons.
What are the options that a homeowner can have with their driveway? I mean, what are the basic thing all the way to the most fancy paving?
Sure. So there's all kinds of options. Typically, most driveways start out with a gravel base that's put in when the house is constructed. Some owners choose to leave that gravel in place. You can maintain that over the years by regrading it, adding a little gravels and top dressing it and regrading and re-rolling. Those areas can also be paved with a couple of different methods behind the paving. There could be a 2-inch single course driveway or a driveway that's a 2-inch base and a 1-inch top coat. I like to call those the Chevy product versus the Cadillac product. There's also porous asphalt that can be installed in your driveway where it actually has a filtration ability to drain water through the bottom of the sub base. That's a little more expensive. That's pretty costly, but around here, it's prevalent where DES requires you to have impervious surfaces pervious surfaces, in your waterfront home area. So if they require you to have pervious surfaces, there's an asphalt option for that.
And we also had Robin Webster of Great Impression Staging. Staging is very important when you're about to sell a house. And she gave us some great tips. Again, let's listen in. What can clients expect if they hire you or a stager who is professionally accredited to do a house?
It's going to give a buyer the excitement when they walk in the door that this is the house for them. And my goal is to have a buyer walk in and not want to go look at another house. They want to sign out that purchase and sales right then on the spot. And if you're fortunate enough and you do everything right, and pricing also is very important. You could potentially get multiple offers, maybe sell for more than you're asking.
What are the different options for a homeowner to stage?
Well, first of all, I really like most people to start out with a consultation.
Yep.
And with that consultation, I give them an education on how staging can benefit them. Because a lot of people don't understand staging. It's been around for about 30 years in the United States, but in New Hampshire, it's really only been in existence for maybe 10, and really the last 5 or so it's taken off. So people need to be educated on how it really can benefit their bottom line on what they sell their house for.
Okay, so what would that consultation cost them if they wanted just a consultation?
A consultation is $200, and typically I meet with them for an hour and a half to 2 hours, and I do a little PowerPoint for them to give the visuals of my work and give them the confidence of what I do. And then we go from room to room, and I make suggestions on what improvements they should make. And it could be cosmetic, could be doing some painting or replacing light fixtures.
So after you finish the consultation, they can still take that information and do it themselves, or they may decide this is really incredible. We should probably go further to the next stage, which is what?
So a lot of times a homeowner will do a lot of the initial decluttering, packing up things that I recommend, and then they may have me come back and do what I call fine-tuning. So I'll spend a few hours in the home, rearrange furniture, artwork, accessories. We'll actually explore the home to find things they probably didn't know that they had that would make great decorative pieces, and just have it the best presentation possible. And a lot of times people aren't in a position to buy anything. We just use what they have. And I did one the other day, and I was in the house for 3 hours and went through the entire house and just manipulated, moved things around, put stuff in the garage, and the house looked fantastic.
We also had a very personal story, which is one of my favorites, stories that we had. Patty Crespo from George's Diner.
Oh, yeah.
She told us a story, a heartwarming story, of how she, over the years, managed to own several homes. And here she is.
I was so inspired by your story. So tell us about when you first bought your house.
So I bought my first home when I was single, and it wasn't my dream home. It just kind of happened, and I thought, you know what? This beats renting, and I'm going to have something in the end, whether I turn around and resell it or if I stay there for whatever length of time. But I can do what I want,
yeah.
And I don't have any landlord to tell me yay and nay about anything. And so it seemed like common sense to do that.
So you were able to qualify for a mortgage.
I did get a mortgage.
And you bought the house.
And I bought the house.
Okay. And you were single back then, right?
And I was single.
Okay. And then what happened in your life after that?
So maybe 2 to 3 years later, I met my husband, and we decided the place was too small. I mean, we did live there for a short amount of time, but two doors down from where I bought became another property, which was much larger and a little bit more suitable for the two of us to be if we wanted to start a family.
Yes.
So we had the opportunity, and I thought it's a great opportunity to do that. So that's exactly what we did. And I had bought my house relatively reasonable when I first purchased it, and I'd been there at this point 5 or 6 years. So it seemed like I didn't have to sell that. We had some money saved to do the second home. So I said, hey, I'm going to keep this house and I'm going to rent it out. And that's going to make us a little bit of money.
Okay. So that's when you became not only a homeowner, but you became an investor.
That's right.
Because you kept that second home and you rented it out and you received income for that, correct?
That is right.
And that was enough to pay that mortgage, maybe?
It didn't pay my total mortgage on my second property, but it paid a good portion of it.
And it allowed you over time to build wealth.
Yes.
Through real estate.
Yes.
And that is a big lesson. I want everybody to hear that. Because today, you can still do the same. Patty started it a long time ago. Today's young professionals who are renting, they're going to do the same. So let's keep going on your story. Then what happened?
So after we had our first child, we decided that we wanted to get into the town of Moultonboro. It had that's where I had grown up, and it had a great school system, and it had great taxes. So we were trying to strive to get over towards that way, even though my daughter was barely a year old. So after the just about 16 or 17 months, we found a piece of property that needed a lot of work. Okay. But it was in the town of Moultonboro where we wanted to end up. So we decided that we would venture over and invest in that property, and we still had the two properties in Meredith. So we kept both of those, and we rented those both out, and that totally paid my mortgage when I was in Moultonboro.
And you're listening to the best of Let's Talk Real Estate for 2019. We're going to come right back and wrap things up with Corina after this on 101.5 Sports Radio Lakes Region.
Bells will be ringing. Sad news. Oh, what a Christmas to have the blues. My baby's gone. I have no friends. You wish me greeting once again.
Okay. Join me next Saturday morning at 8:30 for another episode of Let's Talk Real Estate, where we share important information that will help you with either buying or selling your home. And if you or someone you know is looking to purchase a new home or sell, call me, Corina, at 603-273-6160 for a free market valuation of your home. You can also visit us at our website, nhlakeshomes.com, and visit us on Facebook. You can also listen to our show's podcast on iTunes and Google Play. And remember, mi casa es su casa, and my name is Corina, like the song Corina, Corina. Until next week, play my song!
Corina, 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 I love you so.
Let's Talk Real Estate is presented by the Cisneros Realty Group, powered by eXp Realty, and sponsored by Dana Gunnarsson of the Joe Suazo Allstate Insurance Office, Hudkins Law Title and Settlement, and NCT Nano Coating Technologies. Let's Talk Real Estate is a production of Modern Media LLC, CRG TV, and MR Strategic Alliance, all rights reserved. Join us every Saturday morning at 8:30 for Let's Talk Real Estate with Corina Cisneros on 101.5 Sports Radio, Lakes Region.